Hello, everyone, and welcome to the introductory webinar on the new Bureau of Justice Assistance Body-Worn Camera Technical Assistance Program. My name is Chip Coldren. I'm the Managing Director of Justice Programs at the CNA Institute for Public Research. I'll be working with the Bureau of Justice Assistance and along with Arizona State University and Justice and Security Strategies to develop and deliver training and technical assistance on a variety of aspects and challenges regarding body-worn cameras over the next few years. Thanks very much for participating in the webinar today. I believe this will be the beginning of a very productive working relationship. Let me turn this over to Mike Russa from the Bureau of Justice Assistance for a few minutes for some introductory remarks. Mike?
Great. Thank you, Chip. I appreciate it. Good afternoon. We really appreciate, or good morning for some of you. I imagine this is a nationwide call. We really appreciate you taking the time and attending, and we will be recording, which more details will be going on in a minute for that. BJA is so excited to have this project moving forward. We're really happy that we're able to expand it to the 73 agencies rather than just the 50 we originally thought. We feel that not only did the peer reviewers do a great job of selecting, but on our review, we feel we have some very strong applications, very strong awards, and we look forward to working with you. I do just want to lay out a little bit of information about where we're going to be going, how fast things will be moving. We do need to do some what we'll call level setting on expectations. Right now, what is happening is BJA is reaching out to a few agencies, trying to adjust a few budgets, trying to make sure that special conditions and some information is being collected that are around the grant processing program aspects. At the same time, you provided your applications to CNA, the TTA provider, who will be directly responsible for a lot of the efforts here to review and correlate your applications, to bunch together areas that you identified as maybe needing assistance or areas identified you're working, or maybe just some ideas as to how to move forward. That research or review with the subject matter experts involved is expected to take to mid-November, maybe another 2 to 3 weeks. And after that, you should hear an onslaught of information coming from us, questions, answers, all sorts of components. So I know there's a lot of excitement to get forward. We've had a few requests to start providing funds already. But I just want to lay one very, very clear aspect out. This is not BJA approving body-worn camera policy so we can issue funds. Your policy represents your agency, and that's critically important to your agency, your community, and how it works, and recognizing the difference between agencies and difference between states and state laws. BJA recognizes we can't do that. We can't dictate policy here. But as the solicitation stated, we are basing this program on the COPS implementation guide. If you've been to, which I hope you have, to the body-worn camera toolkit, the checklist is a good example of the COPS implementation guide. It's directly how we created that. That's more along the lines of what we'll be evaluating. How did you do your outreach? How was the policy developed rather than what policy was developed? So we're looking forward to going through those steps, and as we read your applications through in more detail, we figure out the best way to do these measurements. We'll be providing that feedback to you and making sure we get there. Other than that, we're just excited to move forward. At the end of this call, or towards the end of this call, there will be questions and answers, and we'll get into that. But we'll also have a short period where we'll talk about the performance management metrics. It's really the grant reporting method. So if you have some grant report persons available to get on the call, that would be great. They have a little time to get on. If you are that person, that's great. Otherwise, you're going to be hearing about the TTA provider, the Training and Technical Assistance Provider, CNA, and their subject matter experts they've brought to the table. So, again, we've brought a great team together. I really hope you enjoy the presentation, and I'm going to turn it back over to Chip.
Good. Excellent, Mike. Thank you very much. So the purpose of today's webinar is truly introductory. We do not plan to deliver a lot of technical information or a lot of substantive information about the toolkit or the technical assistance that we're going to provide to you, but we want to introduce you to the team and the subject matter experts that have been pulled together and the beginnings of a process for accessing these resources. And as Mike said, we do have some time towards the end for some questions and answers, and in fact, we received several questions from the webinar registration that we'll address too in a short while. So next slide, please. As Mike said, this webinar is recorded. Please be mindful of that. The primary reason for doing this is that there are a number of people who could not join the webinar today, so it will be available on the newly created website for them to review, as will other webinars that we offer over the course of the next couple of years. You will also receive soon after this webinar an evaluation just to touch base with you and see how you're feeling about things, if the webinar was helpful to you, and probably equally as important, to start to get your ideas about webinar topics and other types of technical assistance that might be helpful to you. So please pay attention to that when it comes along. There's also, as I'm sure you can see, there's a chat room available. So if you begin to think of questions or comments as this webinar goes along, please feel free to use that chat room to let us know what your thoughts or questions are. And as we get towards the end, we'll pay attention to those questions as well. Now, in terms of specific topics for today's webinar, we're going to briefly touch on the purpose and goals of this initiative. As I said, introduce you to some of our team members and some introductory words about the technical assistance process and the types of technical assistance resources that we're envisioning for this project, a brief word on some upcoming events. As Michael said, we'll talk a little bit about how you work with the performance measurement tool and then open it up for questions and answers. So again, thanks for your participation. So what I want to say about this training and technical assistance program is that it is not designed to impose a lot of demands and a lot of interruptions on your work. We don't want to be in your business where we don't need to be. The main reason for providing these technical assistance resources is pure and simple: to give your projects the greatest chance for success. Success is important for several reasons, not only because these are projects that you have developed and you are invested in, but the progress and the success and the lessons learned through your projects are going to benefit the law enforcement community in general. And I know that BJA takes this very seriously. They have devoted significant resources in this technical assistance initiative to make sure that the lessons learned are documented and published widely throughout the field. So please don't think of this as just something that you have to be concerned about for your benefit, because the benefits you realize are going to be translated to your brothers and sisters in law enforcement around the country. Clearly, it is our aim through this technical assistance to deliver the most responsive and the most useful technical assistance that you could imagine in a very timely fashion. You'll hear in a little bit that we have started to think about some kinds of technical assistance that we might provide, but I think the generation of technical assistance ideas and topics and resources will come as much from the sites as it comes from BJA and our subject matter experts. And so we have built up a process to make sure that happens that I'll talk about in a few minutes. And we like to think about this as a community of practice. There's as much learning that comes from the PIP sites talking to each other and interacting with each other and learning from each other as there is to have our subject matter experts working with you. So please think of it that way, that whatever questions you have, whatever lessons you learn, whatever documentation you can provide to us will help us all learn about how to make the most effective use of this new technology. Next slide, please. Okay, Mike, back to you for a few minutes.
Great, thank you very much. So programmatically, some of the real keys around special conditions, those areas, are very specific to the agencies that apply. There are some, again, there's, for example, a 10% drawdown availability for reimbursement of planning components as part of the special conditions, part of that ability. So as you do the beginnings of your work on that for where it's federal reimbursement, that's certainly available. So we'd hope you could be there, or we can be there for you to help out with that planning, as well as reaching out to the TAs and the TTAs to help with that process. Obviously, this is more about policy than it is necessarily implementation or development and ensuring success, but we also recognize that some of you have already implemented and already moving forward and you're expanding this with you know, maybe some minor alterations to your policy. So programmatically, I'm not going to beat that down at this point. We have a lot of outreach. We have a very strong program staff. We've actually been assigned two directly to assist, which is unusual for a program. So either most likely you'll hear from one of those two, and we'll be reaching out more. So we'll get the programmatic. Maybe we plan on many webinars and many information, but let's stay specific for this one as an introduction. I did want to introduce the BJA staff that's really doing the work here. Our boss, Krista Mahoney, works for Denise. Denise O'Donnell, who's the director of BJA. Chris Mahoney is the head of the policy office where this solicitation came from. She is a workhorse when it comes to doing this kind of getting help out to local agencies. She comes from a law enforcement background, not a sworn officer, but certainly working in administration for a long time, so she appreciates the difficulties at the local and state level. Patrick McCurry is my direct supervisor. Feel free to reach out to him, particularly if I screw up. Please feel free. Patrick is a great guy. He's a former trooper out of Indiana and can certainly provide a great keeps us safe moving forward and can help out with the direction. Myself, Michael Rose, I'm just a senior policy advisor responsible for this. I did actually write the solicitation. So if you're looking for interpretations of the solicitation to program, please feel free. My cell phone is available. I'm here for you guys. Please feel free to call me, email, text me, however it is. Unless it's my kid's birthday, I will be there for you. Maybe even then we'll figure it out. I do want to introduce Carmen Facciolo as well. Carmen is another policy advisor with this group. Again, it has been an unusual team. We have been able to bring a lot of resources, recognizing the importance here. And Carmen is a great resource, particularly in the adjudication side as we discuss those. So again, please feel free. Stephen Fender, one of the program's persons assigned to this, you probably have already heard from him. He has been the one probably notifying you of partially of award or of things that need to happen. PMT we'll be hearing from, which is the performance management tracking. I know PMT doesn't necessarily stand for that, but Daniel Price is our lead on that, and he'll be explaining more about what the grant metrics in this program are. So as we get down, you'll meet. Definitely want to introduce Todd Maxwell. While he's a contractor for BJA, he has been a significant brains behind the operation. He is responsible for the majority of the content collected from you and from other agencies around you for the body-worn camera toolkit. Definitely a valuable resource for this, so we look forward to helping out. Geraldo Velasquez is just another the great programs person. He'll use Stephen's tag team. So again, we're ready to help you out in Success and Cloud. Certainly, I'd like to recognize her for the work on the toolkit as well as all the others. She's actually been assigned to some other work also, so we'll see less of her. But if we need help, she is a program management expert and can certainly help us work out program management problems anytime going on. So again, we look forward to working with you. There is a large team at BJA. We're really excited to work with you. And beyond that, I'll turn it back over to Chip.
Great. Thanks again, Michael. And it's absolutely true that BJA has devoted substantial resources to this effort. I hope you understand by the time we're done with this webinar today how many resources there are. And I think you should just set yourself a challenge to ask us for as many things until you get the answer no, which would probably be a very rare occurrence. But there are many individuals and many other types of resources that are available, as I said, to make sure that you have the best chance for success. So I'm going to challenge you to do that, to ask us and ask us and ask us until we either run out of resources or exhaust the expertise in this country. Now, I'd like to spend a minute to introduce the technical assistance and training team on our side. As I said, I'm Chip Coldren from CNA. I'm technically the director of this project. I work very close in hand with Denise Rodriguez, who is our project manager. I have been working for the past 6 years with BJA, providing technical assistance and training through the Smart Policing Initiative, which I'll bet that many of you are aware of. And for the past couple of years, we've also been a technical assistance and training provider with the Violence Reduction network out of BJA. So we have a substantial experience, a lot of experience working directly with law enforcement agencies on the operational and administrative side and with researchers on these types of projects. Denise and I are both research partners on what is probably the largest randomized experiment with body-worn cameras in this country. We're just winding down the data collection in the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department. So we have learned an awful lot over the past 2 years about the implementation and the impacts of body-worn cameras. We have another team member with us, Dan Zender from Las Vegas, who you'll hear from in a short while. So that's me. I'd like Denise to introduce herself for a minute or two, please.
Yep. Thanks, Chip. So I've been with CNA for over 7 years, work on a number of projects related to use of force, officer-involved shootings, police accountability, and as Chip mentioned, I'm part of the team that's doing the study on body-worn cameras out in Las Vegas. I've also worked on the Violent Reduction Network and the Smart Policing Initiative TTA projects, too.
Good. Thank you. Dr. Michael White from Arizona State, can you say a few words?
Sure, Chip, thanks. My name is Mike White, and I'm the co-director of training and technical assistance for this project. I'm a professor in the School of Criminology and Criminal Justice at Arizona State University. I've been working with law enforcement agencies for about the last 15 years on a range of issues, including use of force and technology issues. I am not your typical ivory tower professor. My approach when I work with agencies is very collaborative, and it's defined by direct engagement. I've been working with the folks at CNA on the Smart Policing Initiative since 2009. And more recently, my work has focused on body-worn cameras. I wrote a report in 2014 for the Department of Justice that laid out on the table all the key issues to consider, as well as examining the empirical research on those issues. It was called the Assessing the Evidence Report. And more recently, I am one of the primary authors of the Body-Worn Camera Toolkit. The toolkit, the creation of that began back in February. BJA hosted an expert panel where they brought about 100 experts together at the White House to brainstorm issues, and myself and Dr. Charles Katz co-facilitated that meeting, and then based on that, spent the next several months creating the content and working very closely with BJA to get the toolkit live. It went live in May. So that's really what I've been working on. Also, I've been involved on the research side, obviously, given my background. I'm involved in randomized controlled trials, studying the implementation of body-worn cameras in Spokane, Washington, and Tempe, Arizona. So I really look forward to working with all of you over the next couple of years. Thanks, Chip.
Good. Thank you very much. Dr. Katz could not be with us today, but he's also a principal member of the ASU team. And I think we have Shelley Solomon on the line from JSS. Shelley, can you just say a few words?
Certainly. My name is Shelley Solomon. I am the CEO of Justice and Security Strategies. We are a research consulting firm that works with law enforcement agencies. We work with about over 50 agencies across the country, ranging in different sizes. In fact, Dr. Chita can't be with us today because he's on an airplane flying back from he serves as the research partner for Smart Policing in Cambridge. We currently are the research partners for the Miami-Dade State Attorney's Office and also for the Los Angeles Police Department as well. And in that role, we are working on a study with the National Institute of Justice for the National Institute of Justice that looks at the rollout of the body-worn cameras in the LAPD. And are working extensively with them as they work through the policy and the actual technological implementation. In terms of our TA provision, we tend to work very closely with departments, listen to what they need, and then try to work with them to be strategic about solutions. So we're really excited about this project and look forward to working with all of you.
Good. Thank you very much, Shelley. Go to the next slide, please. Very well. So I want to just talk for a few minutes about how we're envisioning this the structure and this technical assistance process. So as Mike said earlier, right now we're in the process of reading each of the 73 proposals that were funded by BJA, and as a result of that review, we will, you know, put our collective heads together and make some decisions about how to organize these resources. We envision that we will have teams of subject matter experts and analysts that will be assigned to groups of grantees. Maybe they'll be grouped by size, maybe they'll be grouped by geography, maybe they'll be grouped by the types of assistance that seems most viable for their sites. So we haven't decided what the grouping categories will be, but by mid-November we'll have a good sense of how we want to create these groups, and there'll be teams of subject matter experts and analysts assigned to each group. And I think the way to think about these subject matter experts is like a conduit, because in addition to the few that are listed on this slide here, we probably have 15 or 20 others around the country who have experience in all different areas regarding cameras, whether it's community concerns or advocacy issues or storage issues, other technical issues, collaboration issues, vendor selection. We have probably some of the best and brightest around the country that have been doing this for the past several years and have direct experience in all these areas. So as the middle of November rolls around and our subject matter experts start to contact you and establish a relationship, they'll probably start by engaging you in some routine conversations, maybe on a monthly basis, just to check in and see how things are going. If any assistance has been delivered, to check in and make sure that you got what you needed and that there aren't any needs that are unmet. But as you work with them, your relationship will develop, and you'll start hopefully to have some conversations about what other types of assistance would be helpful and what else does BJA need to do to make sure this program is a success. So you'll start to hear from us in another month or so, as Mike said, and just consider the people that contact you as your advocates and your conduit to a much broader group of subject matter experts. Right now, so this list is just an example of the types of people that we have on board. So Dan Zender is he's the person in the Las Vegas Metropolitan Police Department who has stood up their entire video camera resource and expertise. Bill Sousa has been one of our research partners at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas, working directly with Dan and the police department. Mike Kurtenbach is the assistant chief in Phoenix, Arizona. Phoenix just completed a very interesting evaluation of body-worn cameras that Mike White and Chuck Katz were involved with, and so he has graciously lent his expertise to us as a person on the law enforcement side who can probably be very helpful. Scott Decker is also a professor from Arizona State University who has been involved in providing technical assistance to police agencies probably for the last 25 years in one way or another. Charles Stevenson is, I would call, something of a technological generalist. He worked for the NIJ Technology Division for about 7 or 8 years. He's now a subject matter expert with CNA, and he has experience with cameras and a number of other technologies. Michael Scott from Arizona State University is the director of the Center for Problem-Oriented Policing. He also has a set of skills and expertise that we think will be very helpful to our grantees. Vicki Hill is I think she's a chief prosecutor in Phoenix now. She worked with Phoenix on their implementation, and so she will be available to help on the prosecution and litigation side, as well as Chris Hammond, who's currently a fellow at BJA working on prosecution issues. So that's just an example. Very soon, we will have out to you a list of the subject matter experts and their areas of expertise so you can make more informed decisions about who you think might be helpful. And I'm just going to encourage you, when your team calls you, when your subject matter expert and analyst team calls you for this initial conversation, please listen to them and please engage with them, and that will start a whole series of technical assistance processes for you. Okay. So as I said, we're reviewing all the site proposals now, and that will help inform our initial ideas about the types of technical assistance we ought to be providing. And again, I will just encourage you to be very proactive in this. If what we're providing doesn't look right and doesn't feel right, talk to us. Let us know what you need. Let us know what suggestions you have. You'll find that we'll be very receptive. And I'm going to go out on a limb and say, more often than not, we'll probably say yes, but I want you to challenge us to say no. And one of the first things that will happen is as you submit your policies for review, we will be involved in that review process with BJA, and we always stress, as Mike did earlier, that the review has more to do with the policy development approach and the stakeholders and voices that were part of that approach, not necessarily a review of what the policy directs your officers and your agencies to do, because that's your purview and your business. I think initially it will be very easy to access technical assistance, and it will probably be always easy to access the TA. As you can see below, we have an email address set up, bwcttaatcna.org, that is active. And so if you start to have ideas, start to have requests, I encourage you to use that. I'll go over a range of technical assistance options in a few minutes. We prefer that the requests come through CNA, so we have a single point of entry for the requests, and once it comes to us, then we will engage with BJA and ASU and JSS and make the determination of which team and which SMEs are most appropriate to respond to your request. So please just pay attention to that. And for starters, you should all be familiar with the BJA toolkit, and if you're not, I encourage you to get familiar with that, because that's going to be the early and probably a consistent driver of the types of technical assistance that we develop and deliver to you. Not that we wouldn't develop new things at your suggestion, but that's at least a starting point. So if you're thinking about, well, what could I possibly need? How could anybody possibly help me? We already have our plans together. Just take a look at the toolkit, and if you feel that you're hitting on all those 8 or 9 cylinders with no problems, more power to you. Probably some things will come up where you might have a few questions, and there might be a possibility that somebody could be of help to you. So that's how we want to at least get started with the technical assistance, with the toolkit as the driver, and with a very simple request process through the email address. You'll see as the website gets put online and as it grows and develops that will become a major supplier of technical assistance to you. There'll be all kinds of information. We'll probably have spaces on the website for the individual grantees to note their progress and note their lessons learned, important documents that they develop. So our webinars will be posted on there, a wide range of technical assistance. So that you should always consider the website as a key means of accessing technical assistance as well. Let's go to the next slide. Okay, so this is just a quick listing, largely based on our experience with smart policing and other projects and types of technical assistance that have been provided in the past. So it ranges from just, a simple provision of information. You're looking for a document. You're looking for a piece of research. You're looking for some information that may exist on a problem that you're facing. And so we can probably very readily track something down and get it to you. It will be easy for us to get an SME or some expert on the phone to talk with you if something comes up that would be helped by that. Obviously, we'll be doing a series of webinars, probably once a month or so. I can think of some topics already that we think might be helpful, like the role of prosecutors in all this, looking at different storage options and configurations, maybe looking at some different collaboration models and making some decisions about what seems to work best that way. Certainly would probably be a good idea to have a webinar or two on data collection and basic approach to assessment and evaluation. So these are a few ideas. I know there are many others. And as I said, if you have thoughts about that, do not be shy. Be direct with us and let us know what you think and what you want. Please back up for a second to the previous slide. Okay, thank you. We do have a speakers bureau in place. It's active. It's been utilized already. So if you're having an event in your location or jurisdiction that would benefit from one of our experts to come and talk about issues from a national perspective or from a regional perspective, we can provide you with a speaker. So please make those requests to us. There are times where we will be able to put an SME at your location. If the need for technical assistance is detailed enough, we have resources to do that. We have resources to bring different sites together. If we see that there are common challenges and common approaches developing that would benefit from a collaboration between two or more of the sites, we have the resources to pull those things together if you would like. We certainly plan to be putting on some regional and topical workshops over the next couple years. We will consult with you on what those topics are, but that's a technical assistance resource, and as I said, the website itself will be a very valuable source of information. Okay. Now, just a brief word on upcoming events. We don't have the official schedule for webinars out yet, but you'll see that fairly soon. And I'll just repeat myself. If you have an idea about a webinar, let us know about it. We're planning. We don't have the exact dates or locations set yet, but in March 2016, there will be a national meeting of all the grantee sites and probably several of our technical assistance providers to accomplish a number of goals, mainly, obviously, you know, developing and delivering technical assistance, providing opportunities for peer-to-peer network sharing, taking a look at the progress and successes in the sites up till that point. So I'm just working on a draft agenda with BJA right now, and as soon as we get that meeting finalized and firmed up, everybody will hear about that.
So, Chip, if I could just throw in quickly,
sure.
BJA recently released the podcast series, as well as there will be a couple links to some additional webinars already available at the toolkit. So if you have some groups, take a look at the podcast. We're releasing a couple a week, I believe. You know, see what fits, and if it's something that's useful to you, please let us know. But again, www.bja.gov/BWC for that, for those podcasts that are available now. You can get them on iTunes and some others. Thanks.
Okay, good. Thank you very much. So in a few minutes, we're going to get to questions from our participants. If you'll just bear with us for a few more minutes, I want to turn this over to Daniel Price from BJA to talk a little bit about their performance measurement tool.
Hi, I'm Daniel Price from CSR. I'm a senior research associate there. I'll be sharing with you in the next few minutes what the performance measurement tool, otherwise known as the PMT, is all about. The PMT is basically just a data repository hosted and managed by CSR. All grantees are required to report performance measures, that is quantitative data, into the PMT every quarter. Grantees are also required to report narrative responses, that is qualitative data, into the PMT every 6 months, in January and in July. Research analysts at CSR then analyze the data in aggregate form and produce grantee progress reports that are submitted to the BJA. Please note that CSR will provide a more detailed training session for grantees on the use of the PMT in the coming weeks. Performance measures are generally defined as metrics used to quantify the efficiency and or effectiveness of a program. Effective performance measures are used to formulate budgets, allocate resources, motivate employees, improve services, and facilitate information exchange between citizens and government. And we'll talk some more about this when we host the webinar in the next few weeks. Next slide, please. So this is basically a summary of the types of data that you'll be reporting into the PMT. So the performance measures would be reported into the PMT every quarter. So for the first reporting period of January 1st through March 31st, you have up to the end of April to report that data into the PMT. And the same goes for the other quarters. Now, for the narrative responses or questions, you provide information into the PMT every 6 months, and you'd also upload that information into the GMS. Next slide, please. Now, grantees are also required to close out their grant when the grant ends. And at that point, you provide a final report as an attachment in the PMT, which you'll transfer into the GMS. Next slide, please. And in the GMS, you can add comments as you close your grant. Next slide, please. So we have a great team of research assistants here at CSR who would be more than happy to answer any questions that you may have regarding the PMT. Once again, we have a training session coming up in the next few weeks, and we'll go into detail regarding all of these steps as far as reporting data into the PMT is concerned. Thank you.
Daniel, thank you very much for that. I'm going to just take a few minutes here before we get into the questions and answers, because we did have several individuals, at least as of last night, submit some questions during the registration process. Mike, I think I'm going to hand this over to you to take a look at some of those questions and give some answers, and I think Dan Zender is standing by to help with one or two of those questions as well.
That's great. Thank you. Yeah, some really good questions and right on point. Just as a heads up, I just came back from the IACP conference in Chicago, and it was such an opportunity to see so many of these service providers in one place and get so many discussions, not just with them, but actually representatives from your agencies, and really talk about some of these. So the first one, and I think this is really critical to set expectations of what BJA will be providing and the TTA provider will be providing and some of the difference in what we provide as well. The first question was, the BWC video must be in a format that can be redacted to be used in court and or for FOIA, a Freedom of Information Act request. This is a time-consuming process. Please discuss the best format for distribution and the best software for redaction, for example, an MP4 format, and please discuss. So this is quite a discussion in the field. It's really a hard answer, and it shows the complexities of body-worn cameras, because we're not talking about a single provider, a single commercial component, and we're not talking about a single agency. But in fact, that they're probably the only place that we have a uniqueness or an area that becomes a point is in the prosecution for the digital evidence for court. An example being San Diego. We dealt with Damon Mosler in that area, and he has to deal with seven different agencies submitting evidence, and I believe three of them, or I should say of those seven, three of them have different body-worn camera systems, which means they have three different redaction tools, three different submission processes, from DVD to cloud-based to internal cloud-based. So the answer to this is not any single one answer, and there is no quote-unquote best format. What we're looking at from BJA's perspective is providing or helping you identify the best services for your agency from all of these aspects, but it's going to be a unique answer each time. One thing we noticed, as I was walking through the IACP components, one of the questions I asked was, how do you do redaction? How does your system handle it? And some said, well, you watch the first part of the video, you identify the suspect or the victim or whoever you wanted to be redacted, and you select that face, and from then on, the system does visual analytics, identifies that face throughout. Except, of course, unless it's an oblique angle and you catch the side of the face, then maybe they wouldn't have done that. So maybe it's better if you select four or five angles of the same face, and it quickly you realize that it gets almost unbearable for the redaction component. Some Seattle was an experiment here, redacted every face, and then you go and you select the faces that you don't want to redact on those same kinds of areas. The biggest area that I see here is we've got to minimize the number of times we watch the video to ensure it's protected. Again, one side face shot could really, really cause danger to a victim or a witness that did not want to be or should not have been exposed. And we know the media will go frame by frame looking for that image. So we want to be really careful there. But the vendors do it differently, and this is the market that we are dealing with. So part of our TTA components is really to help drive that market to answer those problems that you're identifying as need. So you realize BJA doesn't wear any body-worn cameras. We don't do any video redaction. You are the experts, and fortunately, CNA has brought experts to the table to help make this discussion happen. And for example, I'm going to introduce Dan Zedner, Lieutenant Dan Zedner out of the Las Vegas Metro PD, to give some of his perspectives from their agency side. Dan?
Thanks, Mike. Mike is right on target with being unique for each agency. We found locally with our processes that it is time consuming, and more importantly, we tend to focus on facial recognition and redaction, but there are a host of other things: object redaction, audio redaction. All these processes take a lot of time, and so the question about or the comment that it's going to take time, it will take time until processes are codified, especially between the prosecutor's office and the agency itself. For example, who's going to do the redaction? Is it going to happen at the agency? Is it going to happen at the prosecutor's office? If it happens at the prosecutor's office, what's the resource impact in hiring employees to do that? If it happens at the agency, what's the resource impact on the agencies? These are all huge, big questions that need to be answered, and will have to be taken on a case-by-case basis because not one size fits all. To get to the question of formatting, especially when we talk about outside of the court process, the next one would be, of course, FOIA requests or Public Records Act requests by the state. I'm not aware of any states that specifically tell you what format it would that the video needs to go in, but MP4 is a one of the three major standards and probably the easiest to convert from whatever your whatever vendor system you're using, and that also applies to the court system. Unless everything's going to be handled through the prosecutor's office electronically on the internet and moving evidence around, this digital evidence around between prosecutors, it's going to end up at some point landing on a disk and being used throughout the court system on a disk. Smaller courts obviously may not have the technical capability to have an internet website up where you can look at the video. So there's a host of issues there, but MP4 would certainly be in the short term the format to go with, and you can there's plenty of conversion software that's reasonably priced that you can purchase to do that if the vendor does not provide that ability with their program.
Great, thank you. The other questions I think we've touched on, but I'll hit them real quick just to make sure we're on target here. The dates and location of the national and regional meetings, the way we're planning this is a national meeting. We're focused on March. We're trying to identify the correct location. We want to consider all of the grantees in that area, and we'll get that information out as quickly as possible, hopefully by December, if not earlier. Otherwise, the regional meetings are going to be targeted, as Chip mentioned, towards particular aspects. They might not actually be regional in the sense of regional geographic. They might be geared towards prosecution or some other aspect of that we see needed. So there might be some interesting travel here, but we'll discuss that, and we'll take feedback on recommendations as we move forward. The other one was a review of good data review protocols. I think that matches the first question we had. And the last one was really questions revolving around what DOJ is looking for in the implementation plan that must be submitted within 180 days for approval. Okay, so first off, let me say, if it takes you more than 180 days, that is no problem. We want to see the correct policy from your eyes, not from ours, and if it takes longer, do not worry about that time frame. It is not a fixed date. If we take 9 months to develop a good policy and to get it implemented properly and to do the proper community outreach, you know, discuss with the unions and the prosecution and all those things that are built into that, we know procurement can certainly have its own longevity or span. So no stress on those. If it's faster, that's wonderful. But we do need to look at that. Now, what are we actually looking for? I pretty much covered. Really, it's the process for development of the implementation plan, as in the outreach and those other areas, as well as the technical decision and training and those pieces that all go into a good program. So I'm going to turn this back over to Chip, who's going to help figure out how you can submit new questions. Those were the four we had. And Chip, it's all yours.
Good. Thank you again, sir. Melinda, can you please join us and just give a brief explanation to people on how to submit a question?
At this time, if you would like to ask an audio question, simply press star, then the number 1 on your telephone keypad. That is star 1 to ask an audio question. We'll pause for just a few moments to compile a Q&A roster.
Great. So please take advantage of that, or, as I said, use the chat room. And I see we have a question that has come in. So, Dan, we'll probably launch this question over to you. What's the range the camera will record? Can it be used in a 24-hour span and the battery life? So go ahead, and I'm sure you have some answers for that.
Yeah, if you're talking about the span, I guess the question is the range the camera will record is dependent on the manufacturer. The field of view, we're looking at 120 to 130 degrees. And by the way, there is some technical specifications put out by BJ a couple of years ago on recommended standards for body cameras. I don't have the link to that, but I think if you go to the BJ toolkit, you can find a link to it there. The camera can be used generally. The recordings are anywhere from 6 to 8 hours on the low side, 12 on the high side. And they can be used continuously as long as you have them have the battery charge capacity. To fill up the capacity on most of these cameras, you'd have to be recording almost continuously. So I think you're safe with vast majority of the vendors on recording time. Chip?
And this is Mike. I'd love to add that this is one of those areas again. That we've seen differences by locality, by privacy advocates having a big piece to say here, or even the unions being concerned that the camera sees more than the officer sees. And those discussions are still happening. BJA is not going to dictate the camera requirements in the sense of capability. We do have a minimum set that was outlined in the solicitation as well, but the toolkit is always the best place to go. But it is another good example of the differences depending on an agency's desired implementation. I'll make another point that you may have a neighbor that's using a camera system that has a different technical capability than what you're looking at, but for partnering and to facilitate for the prosecution, you've decided to go with the same as the other agency, even though it didn't have the higher level or something along those lines. These are trade-offs and decisions that we have to make, but certainly I think discussions with some very capable people like we have in the room today are why we're here and why the TTA provider is here to have those more specific answers and help you figure out why that question is being asked in the first place so we get you the right answer.
Good, thank you. Hey, Dan, this is Chip. I don't have the impression that there's a great variation in the field of vision across the different vendors. Is that true, or is there a great variation?
Not a great variation. We're talking, maybe 10 degrees, but I know there's from what I gathered at IACP, there is a discussion of some vendors increasing that field of view and capabilities of the camera beyond what is out there now. And, of course, getting back to Mike's point, your local the unique requirements of your local community will certainly drive that. There's a host of issues with, things like night vision and high definition, et cetera.
Thank you. So we have a question here about human resources. So what is the ratio of, I think it's, you know, the ratio of support personnel related to the number of cameras that a department has. And so, and I know this is an issue for prosecution too. Mike, do you want to take a stab at this, or Mike White or Dan?
I'll start it. I'll do the easy quote, the one we've used many times. As you mentioned, Vicki Hill earlier, prosecutor for Phoenix, Arizona. Her number at the expert panel was for every 100 hours of video. That's another legal, well, if you want to get the term right, but basically legal assistance or legal aid person to help review that camera for their staff. So you're talking a direct correlation between staffing and support. Technically, though, this is one of the biggest challenges I've seen in body-worn camera implementations. It really depends on support staff on how you're going to implement. Are you going cloud? Are you going with closed systems that are very easy to replace with a back room full of spares? Do you have the infrastructure that already supports mobile MDTs, CCTVs, ALPRs, and those areas? If you do, this is going to ride on top of those rather cheaply. You already have a strong storage area network, or does your city already have a storage area network where the data can just sit there and you don't have to worry about that as an add-on? These are all great questions, and I think this is where, again, we're going to be doing outreach to help you find your answer, not just a answer. And I'll just turn that back over to Mike White.
Yeah, the only thing I would add to what's been said is that you can look at the toolkit, the body-worn camera toolkit, and it does recommend that at least one person be assigned as the program manager for the body-worn camera program. Now, that person can be someone who's part-time and who's doing other things, or depending on the demands of the program, maybe that person has to be full-time. And one of the things that Mike had said that I think is a big driver of that is the nature of the data storage. And if the data are being maintained locally, then that's going to require, I think, more hands-on involvement of a program manager than if it's handled through cloud storage. And then also the degree of collaboration already with a prosecutor's office in terms of digital evidence. If there's a good platform there already, then that'll provide a nice foundation. So yeah, I think it's going to vary quite a bit based on those types of things.
Thank you. If I could add one thing also, Mike, from an agency's perspective, there are a host of implied tasks with the management of this program, one of which is being an auditing of both compliance auditing and auditing for content of and performance of the officers wearing the camera. So the larger the agency, the more people you may have to bring into this task, whether that's in a centralized unit or distributed throughout your agency will have to be, of course, a decision of the agency. But things like identifying weak practices or strong practices and getting those corrections out to the field or the messages back out to the field, that requires a lot of time and effort and organized process of this operational and training feedback loop. So the more you get into that as an agency and you feel the cameras and begin to find these things, that these missions that you didn't think about before, the more folks that you may have to tie into your program.
Good. I actually think we have somebody waiting to ask an audio question. Is that true, Melinda?
Yes, your audio question comes from the line of Chantel Jones.
Great.
Hi, my question is, if the video isn't reviewed within the 100 hours, would the footage be lost?
That's a great question, but very, very vendor specific. I wouldn't be concerned on any video being lost in any system. This is Mike Rosa, sorry. And if your requirements with your vendor are going to be specific. Now, if you had a requirement that it be done that way, then, of course, you'd be limited by that requirement. But the vendors are not going to destroy any video unless the agency has given them the process for such destruction. So that's really a decision that the agency makes with their contract typically with the provider, or in some cases, that's internally managed.
Okay, thank you.
We have room for another question. Who's ever in the chat room there? Okay. So to me, the camera itself represents 20% of the project, while storage, redaction, and distribution is the largest issue. Is there a company that you know of that offers universal metadata decoding?
So you can certainly have discussions with a CTA provider on what they've seen at agencies. BJA won't go specific to any one agency or any represent any one vendor. We certainly will echo best practices that we hear from agencies. So I'll be quiet and let the TTA providers discuss that more openly.
Dan, you have any thoughts about this?
Not on this one. I'm aware that there is some work being done on this, but again, I couldn't comment on the technical aspects of it.
Okay. How about
just the mic again? I'll be glad to throw in that it depends on your digital media evidence storage components and the layering of your technology. Some of the vendors or applications out there do not allow a third-party application delay on top of it. So you would have to be very careful in your selection of a provider if you were looking to expand in certain areas such as redaction. In other words, if you figured out after you've made the purchase that your data is locked into a particular vendor and you can't change the digital media evidence tools, then you're going to have to figure out how to make that work after the fact. So those are questions we want to ask pre-purchase. But if you purchase a system that's rather open and you can apply other layers such as video redaction on top of, then you can plug in and plug, unplug and plug in something new to make sure it meets your requirements and learn the best practices and work with those. So we do want to be careful. This is where we would say be very careful in making that first purchase. Getting it turned on fast is a good thing. We appreciate that. But getting it turned on correctly is definitely going to cost less in the long run, considering that 80% number of cost is something you don't even figure out until a few months into the project. So it is a really good question.
Yep. And like most questions that we get, that question generates more questions because this field is very young. And I think one of the things that we'll learn as we go along is that these questions themselves are going to drive the field and drive the grant program. So if you ask a question like that, there may not be a direct answer right away, but simply by asking that question, you'll get a number of us talking to each other and better information will result because of the question being asked. So I think we're going to have to draw to a close here. We're 1 minute before 2 o'clock. And I would just encourage you to contact us through that email address. If these questions have not been answered to your satisfaction or if you have other questions, please feel free to do that. And as we said, you'll be hearing from us over the next few weeks as we start to roll out our technical assistance teams and our new products for TA. Let me just at this point thank Mike Russa and his team at BJA, not just for setting this all up, but for working with us very closely on this webinar. Same thing with Mike White and Shelley from ASU and JSS and my team at CNA. I like the way this went. I like the way the questions were asked, and I like the engagement over the answers. So let's just let that be a beginning point for the way we do our work together over the next few years. Okay, Mike, anything from you to wrap up?
Nothing to add. Great close. I really appreciate the attendance that we have, and please feel free to tell anybody in your agency to look up and watch this webinar after the fact.
Yeah, good. Many thanks to everybody.